You are tuned to the Best of Radio EcoShock series on extreme heat.
When Heat Kills, Australia's John Cook, Radio EcoShock, June 2010.
What if Earth becomes too hot for humans to function outside? Science fiction or real science? Let's investigate with Australian blogger John Cook. His well-known blog is called Skeptical Science. John studied physics at the University of Queensland, Australia. He's not a climate scientist, but he relies on peer-reviewed papers by others. Like many of us, John was drawn to a startling new paper recently published in PNAS, The Proceedings of the National Academy of Science. It combines work by an Australian, Dr. Stephen C. Sherwood, from the University of New South Wales, and an American scientist, Matthew Huberb, from Purdue Climate Change Research Center. Sherwood and Huberb investigated the upper limits of human survival in a warming world. Their paper is called An Adaptability Limit to Climate Change Due to Heat Stress. So, John Cook, welcome to Radio EcoShock.
Thanks for having me.
Why is this scientific paper important to the rest of us?
I guess one of the key results is, and I get this on my website a lot, is people say, well, no matter how hot it gets, you know, we can adapt. We can, you know, we'll get used to it, or we'll, turn up the air conditioner or something. But what the paper finds is there is a limit on what we can adapt to, and the human body needs to be warmer than its environment to cool down. So once the temperature gets over a certain point, the body just can't cool down. And at that point, you know, we can go through hypothermia or heat stroke, and, you know, health issues become important.
You know, it's strange that we go through so much education and yet many of us don't really know how our body works, you know, what temperature our skin needs to be and why perspiration is there. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, well, I'm not a medical expert either, but I can give you the basics of it. Like our inner body needs to be regulated at, I think it's around 37 or 39 degrees. And so in order for our body to release heat, the skin temperature needs to be at about 35 degrees. So for that to happen, the air temperature needs to be at a cooler than that, but also what's important is the humidity. You'll find if you're in dry air, the body can cool down easier because it's easier for the sweat to evaporate. But if it's humid, it's harder to cool down, which I guess is when you're in a really hot, humid environment. It's just really uncomfortable. Once conditions get to the point where it's either too hot or too humid or both, and the body can't cool down, that's when the body starts to struggle.
Right. And also, there's something in the paper. We need to go and explain the difference between wet bulb temperature and the numbers that we're used to seeing on a thermometer or a weather forecast. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so I was talking about humidity and how that changes our ability to evaporate and cool. The definition that scientists use to work out what temperature our body needs to be at is the wet bulb temperature. What that strictly means is if you took a thermometer and you covered it with like a wet cloth and it was fully ventilated, you know, there was air blowing past it, whatever temperature the thermometer gave you is a wet bulb temperature. And what the paper found is that the wet bulb temperature can get no hotter than 35 degrees. If we spend more than a couple of hours hotter than that, then you'll get hypothermia.
Right, and that's hyperthermia, listeners. We're used to hearing hypothermia for cold, but hyperthermia is, we call it heat stroke as well sometimes. So the paper says we can't really go over 35 degrees in wet bulb temperature, around 95 Fahrenheit in humid conditions. But right now on Earth, we seldom exceed 31 degrees of wet bulb temperature. So, John, why worry?
Well, what the paper found was that if we experience warming of about, I think it was up to 7 degrees, like large regions of the Earth would actually become uninhabitable. We expect, you know, about maybe 1 degree over the next 50 years or so, depending on how our carbon emissions change. But as we go further into the future, that's just going to you know, the temperature range will get a lot further than that, depending on what our carbon trajectory is now. So probably the most startling result I got from this paper was that we talk about rising sea levels a lot and how as sea levels rise, that'll make a lot of regions uninhabitable. But what this paper found was the corresponding temperature rise will make even more regions uninhabitable. So, I think heat stress is something that probably doesn't get as much attention as other issues to do with global warming. But what we're observing is there are actually more people dying, like currently, from heat stress than other natural disasters like hurricanes and floods. So, it's something that will get worse over time, but it's also something that's happening now. In fact, over the last few weeks, Pakistan and India are experiencing record heat waves, the hottest on record, and hundreds of people are dying there because a lot of remote rural villages just don't have access to, I guess, air conditioners or ways to cool themselves down.
Right. I've been reading about that with some alarm. The latest reports I saw were well over 1,000 dead in India alone and Pakistan.
I hadn't been updated. The last couple of days, a few days ago, I saw several hundred. Right. They said that was likely to be an underestimate because a lot of the reports hadn't come in from the remote villages.
And, of course, they don't have as tight a medical system for measuring just why did this person die. But we're also finding that certain portions of the population are more likely to die. Obviously, I think that includes seniors, but also younger children are passing away. And surprisingly, some people with mental illnesses are twice as likely to die from heat stroke.
Okay, I hadn't heard that. I read a statistic this morning. I think it was just in Australia, but it surprised me, actually. It said that about 10% of the heat stroke deaths were children and about 40% were elderly, but just over 50% were the 10 to 60-year-olds. So, although obviously the elderly and the young are especially vulnerable, there was still a greater proportion were, that just middle range of age. I thought it would have been more elderly, but that statistic surprised me a little.
It surprises me, too. And I know you mentioned the map provided by Sherwood and Huberb in their study, and they say that the sort of lack of habitability of certain areas starts at 7 degrees centigrade from where we are now. But when you get around 11 or 12, they show you another map, which includes large parts of South America, big hunks of Asia, big parts of China, and Australia being totally uninhabitable for humans. They just couldn't go outside and do any work, which would include agriculture, I presume, too. So, I mean, here we have Australia maybe become uninhabitable in 200 or 300 years, and yet the country's ramping up its coal exports. Does the government or the public realize even this extreme risk?
I don't think so, no. And I think the government is more concerned about the next election cycle than conditions a century or more into the future. And that's one of the main problems, I think. It's just hard for us to imagine things that happen so far into the future.
But we have to care about whether our country will go on and our civilization will go on. This is Radio EcoShock. We are talking with John Cook, host of the blog SkepticalScience.com. John, you've accumulated a good community of commenters on your blog as well, and one entry really caught my attention about this heat situation. He said, the difficulty with air conditioning is that most household air conditioners are only rated up to about 41 degrees centigrade, some to 43 degrees, I think. When the temperature rises to 51 C for any length of time, like a summer heat wave, we'll either have to invent better air conditioners and dehumidifiers or find another way to keep cool. And he points out that's only 4 degrees C warmer than it got in the heat wave in Melbourne in southern Australia last year. So there may be limitations to that fallback strategy of air conditioning, not to mention the increased loads often lead to power failures anyway. Can you tell us something about the heat events that you have experienced in Australia in the last year or two?
Well, Australia is... We seem to be copying a lot of the global warming impacts, maybe maybe are less than you might be experiencing over there. But in Brisbane a few years ago, we had a heat wave where about just over 20 people died. In Melbourne or in Victoria, in the southeast of Australia, it's been hot and dry. And the result of that is that it's the bushfire conditions are like, they've had to invent a new scale because the danger has gotten so high. And, you know, we've experienced some very severe bushfires because of that, and whole towns getting gutted over the last few years. So, yeah, there's just been a gradual, I guess, evolution of more heat waves and more dire conditions.
Well, that seems to be the way it goes. I was looking at a paper or figures from the American National Center for Atmospheric Research, and they say over the past decade, daily high record temperatures in the United States outnumbered record lows by 2 to 1. So there are twice as many record highs in the last 10 years than there were lows. So record heat is becoming almost the norm. We hear it so often on the weather forecasts. Is that true in Australia, too? They keep talking about new records being set?
I actually read that paper about the U.S. record highs, and at the time, I also read that a similar study is being done about analyzing Australian temperature record, but I don't think it's come out yet. I imagine it probably is just based on the anecdotal evidence of what we're experiencing. But, yeah, I'm looking forward to when that paper can come out and we can see what the results say.
Well, we'll look for it. And when scientists speculate fossil fuels could drive us to the upper limits of human tolerance for heat, people who I would call deniers routinely fire back ideas like this one. They say, well, scientists can't predict the weather next week, so why should we believe anything 100 years from now? How do you answer that?
I guess comparing weather to climate is like comparing apples and oranges in one sense. And the way I understand it is think of throwing a dice. It's completely random whether you get a 1 or a 6, and you can't possibly predict the single roll of a dice. But if you roll the dice like 6,000 times, for instance, you can predict with reasonable accuracy that you're going to get 1,000 sixes and 1,000 ones. Now, with climate is essentially weather averaged over time. And while weather is random and chaotic, like the throwing of a dice, over time, we can predict how it's going to behave, how the climate's going to behave. And what global warming is doing is it's like weighting the dice. Just so you weight the dice so that you get 6 more often. What we're doing is weighting our climate so that we get record hot days more often. And as time's going on, that's what we're seeing. As that study from the US showed, we're seeing twice as many record hot days as record cold days. And that trend is actually increasing. 30 years ago, it was almost equal, the amount of hot days versus the amount of record cold days. But now it's gradually moved up to double, and it's still going upwards. Yeah, so once you average the weather out over time, we see long-term trends. And the trend at the moment is more record hot days.
I really appreciate the way you put that. I want to move to something else here. John, as I talk with climate scientists, and often after the call is finished, they'll talk to me a little more frankly even, and as I've done some research on the heat deaths, I suspect we may not reach this limit 300 years from now, but much sooner. We already face ongoing series of heat challenges like the hundreds dead in Chicago in 1995 and at least 35,000 killed by heat in Europe in 2003. And as you've said, many more have died in a killer heat wave in Pakistan and India. So I think deadly heat is already underestimated when we talk about global warming. Would you disagree with that?
That's a tough one, I guess. I was looking up some statistics on heat-related deaths, and it is tricky because while the heat waves are getting more often, I guess technology has also developed, so our ability to adapt to it has improved to some degree. So, yeah, I probably couldn't answer that definitively, like whether... The other thing is when they record a person's death, they can put different causes of death. So, yeah, I'm not 100% certain on how accurately they record the exact number of heat-related deaths.
Right.
When we get into medical areas, it does get a little more complicated, I guess.
It is difficult. I know, for example, looking at the official reports from the French government about the deaths there, they said, well, you know, it's possible up to half of these deaths were really caused by the high ozone levels, in other words, really the smog that came out at the same time, but then the smog was worse because of the heat, so we've kind of classified that as a heat-related death. It wasn't a heat death, but heat-related. And also people sometimes come in from smog, they have heart attacks, and that's the cause of death, even though it might not have happened had they been in an air-conditioned room or someone was looking after them. So it's tough, I agree. Well, look, it isn't as though we aren't being warned by scientists or even governments. John, let me read you just a couple of paragraphs from a U.S. government website. It says, for example, by the end of this century, the number of heat wave days in Los Angeles is projected to double and the number in Chicago to quadruple if emissions are not reduced. Projections for Chicago suggest the average number of deaths due to heat waves would more than double by 2050 under a lower emissions scenario and quadruple under a higher emissions scenario. And they go on to talk about California and again, a lot of increase in their heat-related deaths. And even those numbers presume that people will buy more air conditioners and will figure out how to open windows in these closed office buildings and will adapt somewhat. They still expect the heat deaths to go up. I have heard Dr. Martin Cope of CSIRO saying that there's about 1,000 heat deaths in Australia and the heat and the smog increases that by about 20%. So it's coming, mate, but why is the public still so unaware of this growing danger? I just can't get past that.
I actually read a page on the CSIRO website earlier today about that, and they were saying that dangers to humanity, heat wave is almost considered like an ambient background danger compared to like more, I guess, vivid impacts like hurricanes and tornadoes and a twister that we had in Sydney for the first time ever last week, which got a lot of press. I guess heat waves are maybe they're not as sexy and don't get the same amount of attention. But what the CSIRO also mentioned was that the number of deaths from heat waves was equal or greater than the number of deaths from hurricanes and floods and tornadoes all combined. So I think it is something that I only really started to become aware of it when I read the Sherwood paper and when I realised that heat stress is actually making more regions or will make more regions uninhabitable than sea level rise. That was a bit of an eye-opener for me. I always thought of sea level rise in my head as one of the primary impacts on humanity, but obviously there is a lot of different impacts from global warming, and as time goes on, we're understanding them more, and I'm becoming a bit more concerned as I learn more.
Well, me too. I was surprised. I mean, we call it global warming, and it's kind of a, well, duh. I mean, of course people may die of excess heat, but I hadn't really done the research and looked into it, and now I think this will come up as a greater public image, even though we don't find any stimulating footage of the old and the young quietly passing away from heat exposure. we can't show the wrecked cars and houses, but there are definitely holes in some families where some loved ones were. Well, John, we haven't even discussed the impact of heat waves on agriculture. Last year's combination of heat and drought smashed Australia's farm production, from what I've read. Lester Brown warns that rice is already at the limits of heat tolerance, just a couple of degrees more when the plants are setting fruit and the rice crops could fail, threatening millions with starvation. And then you have farm animals who are mammals just like us. They're going to have the same heat problems, and they won't likely be air-conditioned, or some won't even be able to go inside. So I wonder, is it possible that these heat waves, in addition to leading to more mortality, could lead to starvation the way cold and frosts have done in the past?
I imagine so. I know that Sherwood touches on that fairly briefly in talking about how particular cattle will also be affected by it. I don't know of any studies in actual numbers on the impacts. But, yeah, it's when, I guess, climate skeptics say there's a lot of uncertainty, a lot of this uncertainty can go in the other direction. There's things that we haven't even really investigated on how it'll affect us. And I guess heat waves on agriculture is one of those things where we haven't even begun to understand just how bad it could get.
Well, that's a great opening for me to ask you to describe some of your other work you do with your blog. Tell us about The Skeptical Scientist and the issues you cover.
Well, basically, what I'm trying to do is, I guess, just explain how climate skepticism misleads people. Because what I found is, as I've built up a database of skeptic arguments and then looked at what the science says about each argument, I found that what each argument does, all of them have in common this one trait, that they look at a small piece of the puzzle while neglecting the bigger picture. And the more I thought about it, the more I investigated, the more I realized it's almost inevitable that they had to do it this way. Because when you look at all the evidence for global warming and that humans are causing it, there are like multiple lines of evidence showing it. And in terms of the evidence that global warming is happening, there are like tens of thousands of lines of evidence, you know, with ice sheets melting and glaciers retreating and species, thousands of species all over the world are migrating and just showing all these signs in every part of the globe. So we don't just have a consensus of scientists, we have a consensus of evidence. And so the only way really to deny this is to just focus on little bits of the data while ignoring the full picture. So what I'm trying to do is look at each skeptic argument and then present the bigger picture and show how each argument is focusing on just a small piece of the puzzle by putting it into context.
And I notice you've just started appearing on the new climate podcast, Irregular Climate, with Dan Mutal. What are you doing there?
Yeah, well, Dan started a podcast just a few weeks ago and was just, I guess, asking if anyone wanted to contribute among the, I guess, climate blogging community. And I thought I might just have a try at just giving one, I guess, skeptic argument debunk each week. It's the first time I've ever done any recording like that, so it was, I've just done my first one and I have to record a second one today. I'm still deciding which argument I'm going to tackle. So that's an interesting experience, but I think podcasting is good. Like, it's just another way of communicating science, and as you say, there's a lack of awareness among the public. So I probably should put heat stress as one of the high priorities that I should cover, I guess.
Right. From Australia, we've been talking extreme heat with John Cook, host of the Skeptical Science blog at skepticalscience.com. John, thank you so much for your continuing work and the insight you've given us today.
My pleasure.
I'm Alex for Radio EcoShock.